You really worked on, the bios say you worked on the book for 10 years, but you really worked on it more or less for 20. What made you so obsessed that you could do anything for 20 years, even on and off?
What made me so obsessed? I just have to say before I answer that, thank you all for coming. You guys are at the first event for this movie. This is so amazing to me. I know we're short on time, but you know, I just seeing that trailer gets me all verklempt. It's between that and your introduction, I'm like, hi. But
you deserve it.
Thank you. But what made me so obsessed? I mean, I think there are a lot of different answers to that question, and you know, one of them is, in some ways, I've been working on it for 30 years, because I first learned about cells when I was 16 in a basic biology class, and in that moment, I wasn't planning to be a writer, I was gonna be a veterinarian. And I heard just what the cells had done for science, and my teacher said what so many teachers have said, you know, before and after him, which is, there are these incredible cells, they came from this woman, no one knows anything about her, she was a black woman. Like, that was it. And he knew her name, most people didn't know her name, and I, at that point, became completely obsessed. And I think there are a lot of reasons for that, and one reason that isn't actually in, I don't mention in the book, is that at that time in my life, my father had gotten very sick, and nobody knew what was wrong with him. He went from being this sort of marathon running, super healthy, early 40s guy to just completely incapacitated. He lost most of his memories, and he ended up enrolling in a drug study that sort of went very badly for the patients who were involved in it. And so as a kid, in the year that I learned about Henrietta's cells, I was watching my own father be a research subject, and I was struggling with all the emotions of that, the hope that something would go well and it would help him, but also the sort of trauma of watching it. So when I first heard this moment about Henrietta's cells existing, my first question was, did she have any kids? And what did they think about all this? And I think it's because I was a kid going through something that felt remotely similar, and I thought, I need to understand that. And then also the sort of general injustice of when I realized everyone has benefited from these cells, but no one knew who they came from. I was like, that's just wrong. That's just, why don't we know? We should know.
I was sorry to interrupt, but you had said to me on the phone that your father was in this trial, but not only did it not go well, but you felt that some of it was abusive of him.
Oh yeah, and there have actually been things written about this trial that he was in. It was physically very hard for him, and also just, a lot of the patients were not treated very well, and it all kind of fell apart in the end because of some of the ethics of it. So, yeah, without realizing it at the time, because I was a 16-year-old kid, I didn't know what research studies were supposed to look like. I would go to the hospital. My dad couldn't drive because of the sort of brain damage that was caused by this. It was actually a virus. And so I had just gotten my license. So one of my sort of jobs as a 16-year-old was drive dad to the hospital 4 times a week and sit there while he goes through what turned out to be some pretty awful tests and physical trials. And I would sit in this big room at this research institution where lots of patients involved in research trials were treated, and some of them were getting placebos, some of them were getting drugs, and I would do my homework there. And then from that hospital, I went to school, and my teacher said, there are these amazing cells, and I think that's why I really latched onto it in the way that I did, because, you know, obviously my father gave consent, it's a very different story, but you know, I think I was a kid who really connected with the idea that we need to know the stories of the people behind the science. You know, my dad wasn't just a research subject in that moment, it was my dad. And the scientists didn't know, you know, a month before he was a marathon runner and what that meant to his kid who was sitting there. So, you know, I think in part that led to me writing, you know, sort of becoming obsessed with her in that moment. But then once I became a writer, you know, the first stories I ever wrote were about her and the fact that I was obsessed with her, but nobody knew anything about her. So I think it just haunted me, this idea of research subjects being unknown, making important contributions that aren't sort of recognized for what they are.
Your book had an unusual trajectory, too. It's really a long story,
but
you had three publishers before.
I had two publishers? Did I have three publishers? Crown? I think I had two publishers. Yeah, no, you're right. I had three publishers. Sorry.
And,
yes, that's right. I did.
You know, let's face it, a bioethics story, most publishers would say, well, that's not going to do very well. Yeah. Not sexy.
Yeah.
What did you do to make it happen?
Right. So the three publishers thing, I mean, this is not actually, mine was a fairly extreme version of the story, but, you know, in the world of publishing, you know, publishing houses fold, they merge. You know, and initially I was with a very small publishing house that was sort of the only house initially that was willing to take a risk on me. I was a completely unknown writer, and I had this book proposal. I was like, let me do this book. And a lot of the publishing houses were like, science, we've never heard of you. You're 20-something years old. This doesn't seem like a very good idea. But this one publisher did take a risk, and then they folded. They went out of business like 2 months later. And my book got sucked into the parent company, and there it landed on the desk of an editor who wanted me to take the family out of the book. And I, you know, this happens sometimes. Someone inherits a book that, you know, it wasn't their passion project. And so I got in a pretty long battle to try and get my book away, because I just was like, no, there's just no chance that I'm going to take the family out of the book. And so when I eventually succeeded at that, for reasons that they're actually in the movie, this little scene, I then was able to go back out with the same book proposal and try to find a new publisher. And at that point, I had been working very hard to try to become a writer someone might want to take a risk on. I had a few more publications. I started writing for some national magazines. And I think at that point, it landed at Crown and several other different publishing houses. And many people from Crown are here tonight, and I just have to say they recognized the importance of this story very early on, and I showed up to meet with them, and they brought out sort of a team of people to say, like, we get this, and we think this is a really important story to tell. And coming from a year or so of arguing with someone about whether the family should be in the book, I was like, oh, thank God. And then it was still, you know, the editor who acquired the book then ended up leaving. I had a new editor. I think in the end I went through five editors and three publishing houses or something like that before it finally came out. But the people who worked on it they cared so much about it in the end.
Well, let's bring the family in rather than take them out.
nice
good
one. That was good.
Let's meet Shirley Lacks and Jerry Lacks, and also, if you could cue up, we have a clip from the movie. This is probably the first time anyone from the public is seeing this, but it's a very pivotal moment where Rose Byrne, who plays Rebecca, meets Deborah Lacks, who is played by Oprah Winfrey, except we really don't see Oprah Winfrey. We see a character here. So can we see the clip and then meet the family?
Yeah, who's this?
Hi, my name's Rebecca Skloot. How are you?
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Patillo actually gave me your...
How's he doing?
He's fine.
I'm not sure exactly how much he told you about what I'm trying to do.
Just as you was going to ask me some questions about my mama's sales.
Yes, well,
I want to write a book about your mother.
And while there's all this stuff about her sales, it always struck me that nobody ever wrote about her or her life. And that's why I've been trying to track you down and family
down to see if you would be interested in working with me.
And just telling me more about her.
All I gotta say about that is, hallelujah!
Finally, somebody wanted to talk about my mom.
Introduce these nice people. Shirley Lacks was the sister-in-law of Deborah Lax, who unfortunately died in 2009 before the book came out. So you were the sister-in-law.
Yes.
And her daughter, Jerry Lax, is the granddaughter of Henrietta Lax. So we have... Before we go on, how do you think she had the guts to make this phone call? I mean, that's one of the hardest things in any reporter's life, unless you're a bit of a sociopath. To call somebody who you suspect doesn't want to hear from you and to say, tell me your life. It's not easy. What qualities did she have that made that possible?
I think because from what I've heard, Rebecca tried to get in touch with Deborah before Dr. Battillo intervened. And Deborah have always respected Dr. Battillo. He's with the Morehouse School of Medicine. And Dr. Battillo had been working with Deborah, the family, since before the book came out. 1996, I believe.
May I interrupt? This is a physician at Morehouse in Atlanta, who is a key figure in the story. And when you see the movie, you'll see why.
Yes. And once Deborah talked to Dr. Battillo, then she, and I don't think it happened right away. I think she still had her time there where she still didn't talk to Rebecca for a while, and Rebecca finally earned her trust.
Was there something about Rebecca that was exceptionally trustworthy that she responded to? Because, you know, most people think of reporters as these characters out of Ernest Hemingway, and they're sort of elbowing their way everywhere. But I think the really successful reporters are more like Rebecca, who, you know, they're slow, they take their time, and they win trust.
Yeah, well, like my mom said, it took Rebecca a while for Deborah to actually trust Rebecca, like a year or so?
Yeah, that phone call, it makes it seem like we were just in. Right. She hung up on me at the end of that call and wouldn't talk to me for a year and a half. So it was that was the very beginning.
Yeah, so I think like in between, Rebecca was sending Deborah information, like pamphlets, newspaper articles about Deborah's mother. And I think Deborah had a feeling of like, okay, I can trust her because she's giving me what I've been trying to get for so long, for so many years. She's giving me information about my mother instead of trying to get information from me. She's actually giving me information. So I think it was more of Rebecca giving Deborah what she was looking for so many years. And I think that's where that trust came in.
Jerry, you said to me on the phone that Deborah had a real deep need to know what happened to her mother, and nobody was telling her. She was 2 years old when her mother died, and was that story within the family kind of a murky, airy thing that people knew about but didn't talk about?
It was. And I guess in our generation, the grandchildren, we didn't know anything about our grandmother. We knew she died of cancer, but we didn't know exactly what type of cancer. We knew her cells contribute to science, but we only knew two things, and it was the polio vaccine, and it went up to into space. That was it. And I guess because of Henrietta's children didn't know any information about their mom, so they couldn't tell their children about our grandmother. So I guess, you know, when the book came out, that's when we found out so much information about our grandmother as a woman and as a medical hero.
Yeah. Shirley, what you were close with Deborah, and Deborah is a key part of this story. It probably wouldn't have happened without Deborah's cooperation. What did she tell you she knew about her mother?
Deborah didn't know anything about her mom before she met Rebecca. Oh, she knew that her mom had passed away at an early age. But most of everything that she found out was in through by Rebecca. And I just want to back up to say that once Deborah felt comfortable with Rebecca, she called me and she was saying, "Yes, Shirley, I got somebody that's going to finally tell me about my mom's going to help me find out information about my mom." And she was just so excited because she, for so long, she always, when we were like 16, 17 years old, she always have said, you know, especially Mother's Day, she would say, I wonder how it would feel to have your, to be with your mom on Mother's Day. And so she was just had that hunger. And when she got finally got that trust with Rebecca, it just went viral. That's what I call it. Just went viral. She just decided.
You, Rebecca, you two became very, very close and began investigating this together. In what ways did Deborah help you find clues to the mystery?
You know, in a lot of ways, the time that we spent together, it's hard to separate out. A lot of it was about her. So what Deborah was able to help me understand was her journey and the journey of the kids and what they went through with the cells, you know, because we often, when you talk about the story of Henry Lacks, people focus on the cells. They took the cells without asking in the 1950s, but that was just the beginning of the story. In the 70s, scientists went and tracked down her children to do research on them in order to learn about the cells without getting their consent either. And in fact, in 2013, it happened again. And so part of the story of the HeLa cells is, every generation since Henrietta has been sucked into this research without their consent. And each generation, in some ways, it's a bigger violation. So each thing has happened. So with Deborah and I, so much of what she helped me uncover was her own story and the story of what happened with her and her family. And she would, you know, I spent a lot of time in archives and things that would have been very boring to put in the movie. And then I would gather, like Jerry said, papers and things and bring them back to Deborah and talk to her about that. And we would, she would sometimes come with me to Clover, the town where Henrietta was from, and be there when I talked to some of the more distant relatives. And one of the things that always was sort of amazing to her is that these people had been in her life, you know, since she was a baby. And they had information in their brains that they had never told her, even though they knew she was so hungry. And she would sit there and listen to them, watch them tell me things and go, like, why did it take somebody else coming and asking these questions to get this information out of you? But her presence in the process helped to make it possible to do quite a few things, even just legally, you know, getting Henrietta's medical records, going to the hospital where her sister was when she was, her sister died in an institution when she was 15. And, you know, some of those things could not have happened without Deborah. But so much of that is actually Deborah's story, as much as it is anybody else. So the reporting process was a lot of that. It was understanding Deborah's story along the way.
You mentioned the recent violation of people's privacy and some of the people on the stage come in to that. Can you describe what happened? Because it's really shocking.
Yeah.
And it's kind of a parable for everybody to know.
Jerry and I, we can both also start. So in 2013, so 3 years after the book came out, a group of scientists sequenced the genome of the HeLa cells, which means, you know, I mean, I think most people kind of vaguely know what a genome is at this point. It's like it's all of your DNA, all of your genes, all the information that sort of in various combinations makes you you. And in the HeLa cells, they are Henrietta's cancer cells, so they're not her normal cells. So their genome is slightly different, but Henrietta's in there. So you can learn a lot of private information about Henrietta from the genes in the HeLa cells, which means you can also learn private information about Jerry and her children and her father. And so this group of scientists sequenced the genome and just posted it online for anyone to download. And I learned about this in the same way a lot of people did, which was the researchers put out a press release, the research institution saying they'd done this, and they put an FAQ with it, and there were two questions, essentially, that I remember. One was sort of, why is this important to do? And it talked about the value to science, which is true. It's very useful to know what makes HeLa cells, genetically for research. But then the second question was, are there any privacy concerns? You know, could you learn anything about Henrietta from this? And the answer was no. And what was amazing to watch was that on Twitter, so this happened, the press release went out, and all these geneticists went, what? and just jumped on it and said, first of all, whoa, we of course we were curious about this genome, but nobody was going to sequence it, and didn't you talk to the family? And so this started a debate.
What are the real life implications of having your genome known?
Well, that was sort of one of the questions.
Can you get health insurance, perhaps?
Yeah, some of that, but it was more, you know, a lot of people have heard of 23andMe, like the company where you can, you know, get a swab, and you can do that. You can make a 23andMe report on Henrietta from this information. So you can learn, does she carry the early onset Alzheimer's gene, which maybe Henrietta's family doesn't want to know if she does, because there's nothing you can do about that, you know. And there was one of the jokes in the family is that one of the genes in there was for not being bald, right? And, you know, her brother is totally bald. But, you know, so some of it is light, but some of it is very heavy. And people go through a lot of genetic counseling to decide if they want this information. And yet again, a sort of third generation of Laxes was not given the option whether they wanted to participate in it. So I called Jerry when this happened, when I saw it, and I went, I'm guessing you don't know this just happened. And I mean, I'll say what your questions were, you could take it. So I think her response says so much about the family, because she's had two questions. She said, can you get them to take it down until we know what this means for the family? And how will it help the world if we let them do this? Which just says so much, I think, about where you guys are, that, you know, you're proud of the cells, but also want to protect your family. So I don't know if you want to talk about what happened after that.
Okay, it's just, we met with the director of NIH, Dr. Francis Collin, and Dr. Kathy Hudson, I forgot what her position is, and we met with several other people from Johns Hopkins, and we had Rebecca there as well, and we just kind of came together as a family, several family members, just to figure out what it meant for our grandmother's genome to be published publicly. So when we sat down as a family and got a kind of better understanding of what was going on, they gave us three options as far as if we want to have her genome published publicly, anybody could see it, or we can have restricted access to the publication, or we can just take it down at all. I mean, take it down and just not have her genome online. So we said we did not want to stop, you know, science. So we said we would not, I mean, we didn't want that option as far as them not posting. Then we didn't want our information out there just for anybody to click to find out information about, you know, Henrietta, my dad and his siblings, and then the grandchildren. So we just came up and said, okay, we'll go ahead and do with the restricted access, which has two family members on board. And it's like, what is it, like a committee? It's a committee, and researchers have to go through this committee. They have to meet certain criteria in order to have access to the HeLa genome. And two family members are on board, and we were, you know, grateful for that, because now we're at the table making decisions instead of people, you know, just telling us what's going on. Now we know firsthand what's going on. So I thought
it was
really great.
It's historic, because this has never happened. So this committee has four NIH scientists, I think, and then two family members. And this is this moment where, you know, research subjects or tissue donors, even though they weren't donors, have been brought in as sort of partners in this process. And this is just, it's never happened before. And what's amazing about it is it didn't have to. There's nothing legally that says that this couldn't happen. So there was no law saying this genome had to come offline. There's nothing saying these scientists have to go through this process, but they do, because everybody has sort of recognized, or a lot of people have recognized, that the current guidelines are sort of not protecting the privacy of particularly the Lax family, but, you know, in some ways a lot of people. So it's, you know, what I've seen, you know, Deborah, there's a scene at the end of the book that's a baptism. It's actually Jerry's daughter who is in the audience tonight, no longer an infant. And there's this incredible moment in this baptism where Deborah's husband, who's a preacher, he was holding Bria, and he said, you know, to Deborah and her brothers, he said, Deborah, you and your brothers are not going to benefit from this story. Like, this story has already happened to you, but this child is going to someday know that her great-grandmother changed the world, and let her take this story and let it teach her she can change the world too. And then there were all these kids in the room, and that child, and that child, and that child. And those children are all growing and grown now. And the thing that's the most incredible to me, that was sort of the end of the book. That was the last chapter of the book, until much later when Deborah died, I updated it and changed the ending in the worst way that I could have imagined. But what she wanted more than anything was that. She always said, I want this story to help the future generations of Laxes change the world. They go out and do amazing things, and that's what they're doing. I mean, they go and they travel and talk at universities and research institutions. They consult on consent forms. I mean, you can give them a list of some of the greatest hits of where you guys have been and what you've done, but it is incredible.
You know, that's one of the remarkable things about the Lax family, the pride people take in what those cells have done. You could take it another way, and yet you've chosen to be very positive about something that wasn't done with her, but to her.
Well, Jerry's father, David Lax, when all this happened, his sister passed away, and we started out on this speaking engagement. When he would go out, and when he would talk about his mom, he would say that, you know, it's no use me being upset because I can't change anything. He said, my mother have done a lot for the world, and I'm proud of that. And he always would say, it gives me a warm feeling all over, especially when he go out in the speaking engagement. He see a lot of young people talking about his mom. So we just try to make sure that we keep that positive image, because as he said, that has happened. We can't change anything, but we can help to continue to keep the legacy of Henrietta alive, letting the world know that this woman that helped the world had a family. She was a person like everybody else. So that's why we kind of trying to make sure that we keep a positive image out there. It's no use having anything negative because we can't change anything.
Let's invite two more voices to join our panel. Here are two of the stars of the film, Rose Byrne and Renee Elise Goldsberry. Barry, forgive me, I'm sorry. Renee Elise Goldsberry is a Tony Award-winning actress and singer. She was in the original production of Hamilton, and she plays Henrietta Lax in the movie. Renee, would you join us?
Welcome.
So how did you prepare for this role? Because there's no film footage of Henrietta Lax. There hardly are any pictures. She's more a mirage than a real person to even to her children and grandchildren. How did you form your character?
Well, I have this book, and so much of it, you know, so much of it is really uncovers this woman. I feel that she's very present in the novel, and so that was very helpful to me. She really did take time with her in that book, and so I didn't feel that she was a stranger to me. And I also, you know, I also have a grandmother who was born at the same time. I mean, I am this family. Do you know what I'm saying? And so, and even just, you know, placing, you know, my mother, you know, with her, my grandmother with her. I mean, just immediately showed me who they were. So I felt that I knew them very well. And I also just had the spirit of Henrietta Lax, honestly. That was all something that I knew before I showed up to the set. But showing up to the set and seeing the world that George C. Wolfe, the director, you know, these little vignette moments that he would kind of flash back and share share that world with us. That was really, he really created very rich moments, and just stepping onto those sets, and then there was the spirit of this woman. And you know, sometimes you have the honor of telling a story that is ready to be told. You know, sometimes you have the honor of portraying a person that is, you know, it's really bigger than anything we could do here. So, you know, thank God for HBO and for Oprah and for Harpo, and most importantly, thank God for Rebecca and for these people that were so willing to allow us, you know, everyone has to keep saying yes, basically. There's, you know, you see that moment of Deborah saying yes. We all have to keep saying yes, and at the other side of yes is a real blessing to us. So I was definitely blessed by it.
Do you think someone without the great power of Oprah, this film would have gotten made? Could you,
who knows? It's crazy. You would probably answer that question better than me.
I think I have no doubt that it would have somehow happened. I mean, Deborah, you know, I had, when Oprah was preparing for the role, right, I had all these audio tapes of my time with Deborah, hundreds of hours, and I was listening for clips to give to Oprah to kind of give her a sense of who Deborah was, and there was this moment of us driving in this car, we're just like going to get something to eat, and Deborah's going, "This, you're gonna finish this book, and this is gonna be a bestseller, and it's gonna be a movie, and Oprah's gonna play me in this movie," and she's just like, "Deborah, Deborah, Deborah, Deborah," and I was sitting there in the background going, "Deborah, Deborah, Deborah,
oh
Deborah,
my God,
this is like, no," and you know, and so I don't think there was ever an option for Oprah to not make this movie, because I just don't even think it's on the table. Like, there was just, it was happening, and Deborah said that. I mean, that was like 2000.
Wow.
That was, there was no book, there was no book contract. I was a student, like, and I was sitting there going, "I'm gonna be really excited if I find a publisher. And like, I'd be really crazy if people bought it, and that'd be amazing." And like, "Oprah, whatever." Like, and I was in the background doing that the whole time. And so, yeah, I just think,
but I feel like I see that happen, you know, from, you know, in the present, when you're imagining something like that, it seems absurd. But when you look back and you see those kinds of stories, it makes you feel like there was always a plan. Mm-hmm. And I feel that way often in my life, and I feel you know, really grateful when I have those moments that just kind of are really there just to show me, see, this was gonna happen.
Well, there's a mystical quality to your performance. We're gonna call Rose Byrne out, who is the doppelganger of Rebecca.
Yes, she is.
She's her twin. But first, we're gonna see Henrietta Lacks. Mm. Can we see the film? Because this is really extraordinary.
Beautiful. Thank you.
And when all her cousins move from down here to Turn Station, he'll take care of them.
Okay, now which cousin are you?
Cousin Fred, ma'am.
Oh, don't call me ma'am. I'm too young to be anybody's ma'am. Call me Henrietta. Bring me your plate.
Hey, babe.
Half of them fool wasn't even relation, but she feed them just the same.
Everybody up in here, family. Make sure you have enough.
She always kept herself real pretty.
Oh,
you looking good, baby.
Fingers and toenails painted red.
Now, Cousin Billy is the best carpenter side Jesus himself. Ain't that right, Cousin Billy?
Well, I guess.
I guess. If you be it, say it. Ain't that right?
That's right.
Now, okay, girl, go on over there.
Rebecca Skloot, will you join us, please? It's like seeing Harpo Marx and Lucille Ball in that. You know, the two of them are such twins. How did, she's Australian, not Chicagoan. How did you get your character?
Well,
did you hang out together? Did you?
What a great subject. Rebecca was great. She was so candid with me. We immediately started to Skype and talk on the phone, and we were in touch straight away. And then we got to spend a really great, solid amount of time together in Atlanta, where we shot the film. And like I said, she was very candid, and we went through the whole script and all the beats, and she had so much footage with photos and audio footage of her and Deborah talking, and Rebecca's very talented at explaining to like an idiot like me about the science, because that is so complicated and complex. I'm not a scientific person at all, so that was a real blessing to have someone who could translate a lot of that stuff, because a lot of my, you know, the character Rebecca's dialogue is that stuff. So
when actors build a character, they often look for the heart of the character, what it is that moves them and motivates them. What did you see in Rebecca?
So you guys can talk about me. I'm gonna go.
Yeah. Great hair. She's a force of nature. She's a force of nature. There's not many people who could be as willful, I think, and stubborn in a way to really, really, really get done what she wanted to get done. Because as she says, it's been nearly 30 years of her life of an obsession with this, but she really is a, yeah, she moves at a very fast pace, and she is a good journalist because she sort of pretends she's not moving at a fast pace, but her brain is going 1,000 miles an hour, kind of thing. But it's interesting, I've never played someone who's, you know, alive and well. So at a certain point, I kind of had to like let it go and just do the character that was, you know, I couldn't because it's too much to try and, you know, have that. It has to become your own as an actor eventually to be able to tell that version of the story that we were telling.
So Rebecca, what did you feel seeing somebody walking around imitating you or channeling you? Or
it was amazing. And you know, I think there were a few moments, I don't know that you've even heard these stories, but the moments that I really saw her being me, it's sort of the strangest out-of-body experience I've ever had. But actually the first moment I showed up on set, and Jerry and Shirley were there, I showed up on set and weirdly showed up wearing exactly the same outfit she was wearing. Like,
that was so strange.
Perfect, exact, like same tie around the waist, same dress, same everything. Yeah. And it was because like, her character had so gotten, you know, the costume people had so gotten me as a character that I weirdly showed up all these years later wearing the same thing, which made me go like, oh my God.
That was surreal.
But we were walking around on set that day and I was with several of the Laxes, and we all had these headphones on, you know, walking around set. We were like going to the snack table, and through the headphones, I heard myself. And I can't even remember which Laxes it was in front of me. I know Davon was one of them, stopped and turned around like, what? And it was just not even, and then we all kind of went, how did you get in the headphones? And I did the same thing. I was like, was that my tapes they were playing? And then we realized it was you.
Wow.
On the set where we weren't, so we couldn't see her. And then we were all like, oh my God. And things like that happened, just the physicality of the character. My dad watched little clips and was completely freaked out by how she moved like me. And, you know, but to me, one of the biggest moments like this, I was sitting alone in a room with a computer screen where we were screening some stuff. And I had one of those moments, you know, when you turn your phone and you turn your camera and it's accidentally facing you, and you go like, oh. I was sitting at the screen and I pushed play and your face was like, it was a close up and I looked and I had a moment like that where I actually thought it was me. So clearly the physical nature of it, she nailed in a very clear way. But also, you know, it's a hard character to play. I mean, I very intentionally, I didn't want to be in the book at all. I was like, this is not my story, this is about them. And for various reasons that would probably take a long time to explain here that we don't have, but I just realized that it wasn't that I was sort of inserting myself in their story, but as Rebecca the journalist, I was another character in their story, another person who'd come along essentially wanting something from them. But then in the process of writing it, I really intentionally left out my personal story. So I'm a very intentionally one-dimensional character in the book. So to see Rose take that and, you know, you don't learn that much more about my life in the film, but I think the way that, you know, she created me as a living, breathing person, there is more dimensions there than you get on the page in some ways. And I think a lot of that is that time we spent together, you know, we went through the script, but also, she, you know, we talked about what was happening, what was motivating you, what was your life like? So what I felt like was that through doing that, you know, the time that she/you spent really kind of learning about what wasn't in the book and what wasn't in the movie, I saw how that you inhabited the character in a way that was had more dimensions than in the book. So it wasn't just the sort of, you know, a mimicry, right? Like, you're great at doing my voice and stuff, but it was more of, you know, bringing the character to life in a way that I kind of intentionally didn't do in the book. And of course, then it's different, right? Because as you say, you can't make this a perfect, you know, it cannot be the exact same character. And also because of the nature of the length of movies, like you know, that was a 15-year process of evolution for me, and there was a 95-minute one in the movie.
Oprah is remarkable in this movie because, think about this, here is a figure that all of us know, and the minute you see her, you think Oprah. And yet, she's a character. She is Deborah in that movie. You don't see Oprah. Was she Deborah on set, or did she move in and out?
She was pretty different on set. She wasn't like, you know, Oprah Winfrey or whatever. Like, she wasn't like that. She
was like, except when she brought out the crab cakes.
Yeah, except occasionally you'd see it. Her character would come out of her personality, but she was reserved. And I think she was preserving her energy because the role was very kind of demanding physically and emotionally and spiritually. It was a lot. It was a lot of responsibility. And she just as simple as like she looked so different and she had to move with a limp and, you know, it was very, very, so I understood that. I respect anyone's process and she was just, you know, conserving her energy, I felt like.
I didn't have the strange thing as I'm playing her mother in this movie, which is so amazing. no, I mean, it's like the coolest, that's, you know, it's kind of why I'm like, yes, I'll take that job. But I didn't for that reason, since, you know, she was 2 years old when Henrietta died, so we were never in scenes together at all. I just randomly saw her in the trailer from time to time, and I just love, I love, you know, the opportunity, and you've heard me talk about this, you know, as an actor to serve something, because so much of all this seems to be in service of us, you know? And clearly Oprah doesn't need a job or an Emmy, you know what I'm saying? You know, she does, I believe, these things because the story has to be told. And I loved sitting in the trailer and seeing, you know, just kind of out of like my peripheral vision, like acting like I'm not looking, but you know, like a decision made of, you know, what I'm good, you know, her hair is fabulous, do you know what I'm saying? And you know, there's no image of what Oprah is that I felt kind of invaded the artistic decisions of I felt like she really served Deborah. And the different moments and times in our life.
I want to hear these guys talk about that.
Yes.
Yeah. I want to hear, because we actually haven't, you were saying that you sort of really lose Oprah and that she becomes Deborah. I'm curious about who knew her.
Two questions. The first is, what did the family think of Oprah's performance of Deborah?
No, I thought it was excellent. When I first found out that Oprah wanted to actually do a movie, and when she made the announcement, and I said, oh my gosh, she made the announcement on my aunt's death anniversary, which was May the 12th of, I think, 2010 or 2010. And I was like, this was, as Renee said, you know, some things are just meant to be or planned. And I think she did an excellent job with portraying Deborah. You know, because Deborah, she kind of like up, down, and then she's very lovable, she's fun, she's caring, she's very creative, and I think Oprah did portray Deborah, and especially when she had the cane. When Oprah had the cane, and when Deborah was alive, our family used to tell Deborah, you know, Deborah, you don't need a cane. Why are you walking with a cane? And then in a movie, it's a scene where Oprah jumps out the car without the cane. And I was like, oh my gosh, they have that in the movie. So that was real good character.
The actresses here can confirm that most actors, when they're very big stars like Oprah, they don't let themselves be seen she really hangs it out in that movie. I mean, she is not beautiful Oprah. She's an older woman who suffered a lot of stuff. Mm. What do you think of her bravery in doing that?
I'm inspired by it. I kind of feel like that's the whole point. And it's good to see that example. Really, it just motivates me, you know.
I think that's great. Totally. She has no vanity in the performance, which is key, because you couldn't do a performance like that with any sort of self-consciousness. And she really trusted George Wolfe. You know, that was a huge thing. Her and George Wolfe have a very great relationship, and she really trusted him. And he was our leader and guide, and she really leaned on him a lot. She's very funny, Oprah. I mean, she's funny. She's Oprah. She's funny, but like, she's a funny actress. Mm. She would find a lot of comedy in the scenes, and
I'd always say to her, you should do a comedy. She'd look at me like I was crazy.
Shirley, did she talk to you about Deborah?
Well, not really. She came to Baltimore because she wanted to get a feel for Deborah. And she met most of the family. Yes. And she talked to all the family members. She did not miss not one person, even the little babies. She picked the little babies up and was talking to the little ones. I just take her as a people person. And her spirit is just the spirit that she had within herself, because when she came in, she did not come in flamboyant or anything like that. She just came and said, hi, family, and we looking around. You know, we were expecting her to come in to make a grand entrance, and she did not. And we were just...
Well, in fact, she sat down and told you she was terrified, right?
Like, I mean, it was sort of an amazing moment. Yes, she sat down in a room with, there were maybe five of the people who were closest to Deborah, and just said, I'm terrified of this. And you could tell she was terrified, and it was an amazing... You were consoling her. You were like, you've got this. Deborah's got you. Yes. You're cool.
Yes. Yeah.
And it was an amazing thing to see, right?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. I was just surprised for her, because I've always admired Oprah, because she used to be an anchor woman in Baltimore. Never in a million years I thought I would meet her. And if I did, I never thought I would be that close to her and have a conversation with her.
Well, let me ask about some of the issues that the book raises. Actors, family, Rebecca. Do you feel it's changed the way people feel, perhaps how you feel about issues like informed consent, the way large institutions treat ordinary people and people who are maybe not advantaged? Do you see some changes because of the book?
I'll just start it, because I'm going to volley it back to Rebecca, but at 11 o'clock? What time was it last night?
We started about 12:30, I think.
I was, for whatever reason, last night I called her and I texted her, because we've never really spoken outside of this one cameo she has in the film, specifically to ask her, because I was just realizing, I'm speaking as an authority on something and I don't really know what happened with the science after 2009. And it's 2017, and so I don't want to be, sitting up and saying all these things without knowing what's actually happened since then in terms of any law, that protects any, people's rights or privacy or anything. So I called Rebecca, and we were on the phone for a couple of hours. She was like, are you sure your brain can take more? I'm like, yes, tell me more.
Amazing.
So do you want to share?
So are things better or worse than in 1951?
Things are better, things are the same. It sort of depends on how you look at it. So the sort of condensed version of how things have changed. So what happened to the Lax family, Henrietta's kids in the 70s, couldn't happen today. That's illegal. Scientists cannot go to someone, take cells just for research without asking them, which is what happened to her kids. But what happened to Henrietta, scientists taking samples for, as part of a medical treatment or something else. And as long as samples are taken for something like that, that's not just research, and scientists are wanting to use the leftover tissues in research, as long as your name is removed from them, which at the time Henrietta's was, that doesn't require consent. So what happened to Henrietta still happens all the time. It's pretty standard practice, as it was then. But things really changed for a lot of the rest of research on human subjects. We didn't have informed consent in the 50s. Obviously, we have a very rigid, careful consent system now. But this question of what to do about tissues is still a really live one. And there was a proposal to change the federal law or the regulations that govern tissue research. And it was going to be changed to require consent for all tissue research, in part because we now know it's technically possible to take an anonymous DNA sample and figure out who it came from. It's not easy, but the fact that we know it's possible now means, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, what are we gonna be able to do with anonymous samples? And the federal regulations hinge on anonymity. So if it's anonymous, you don't need consent, but if there's no such thing as anonymous, what does that mean in the future?
So this is a very contentious subject. So this proposal to change the guidelines to require consent was met with a tremendous amount of backlash from the scientific community. And in the last week of Obama's presidency, it was kind of headed towards becoming a regulation, and that part of it got removed. And no, we didn't really hear about it because everything became about Trump's inauguration after that. But so it was this moment where the law was about to change, but then it didn't. So, and there's still a lot of discussion about that. And part of the reason why it didn't change is because, I mean, there's a lot of technical reasons about some problems with the way they'd proposed changing it. But I think we haven't heard the end of that. This is going to be an ongoing discussion for a long time. But one of the things I've seen, both with the book, with the speaking events I do, and also with the speaking events you guys do, is how much the story, and I think meeting the family and hearing you guys talk about your experiences, is changing the way scientists think about tissues and the DNA samples they use in their lab, which sometimes are like strings of code across the screen. They're completely disembodied from a human. And bringing the human back together with the samples is something that that was one of my goals with the book. And I think you guys, you can talk about this, like they hear from scientists all the time that this is making them think about their research differently, right?
Yeah.
What's the attitude of Johns Hopkins to having this giant scandal sort of in their history, and yet there's a groundswell for change. What do they do with this? What's their attitude for the family? For instance, do they give you free treatment?
We wish.
Yeah. Well, I was just asking. It was a provocative.
I've thrown that out a couple times, but of course that hasn't happened. John Hopkins really hasn't done a lot. The only thing, I mean, as far as really helping the family, because we have some family members that are older and in need of some medical care. What they have done is we have what. Microscope Day.
We did Microscope Day.
And then they have a foundation set up with one of the school, scholarships set up with one of the schools that's next to John Hopkins Dunbar. And they do symposium every year, and I think it's like in October.
So all these things, right, are named after Henrietta.
Right.
Honor.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and these are, in honor of Henrietta, but as far as doing anything for her siblings, they haven't reached out yet for that. I asked them to build a wing for Henrietta. They are talking about.
They're talking about a building.
They're talking about a building.
They might.
Yeah. So we're waiting to see what happens with that.
Yeah.
Well, not the pathology lab, we hope. What about health insurance? Is that an issue for the family? Because I would think with your genome being published, it could, as well as how expensive it is.
I want to just clarify something about the genome and the health insurance. Yeah. There's actually a federal law that says that health insurers cannot discriminate against people for genetic information. So no insurance company could say we're not going to insure them because there's something in Henrietta's genome. That would not be possible. But access to care is obviously.
Mm-hmm, but everybody has, health insurance, and then because of the Affordable Care Act, everybody has health insurance. And like my mom, and as my mom had mentioned earlier, we think that other, medical institutions could, we're not asking for money, but health insurance, that would be a great deal to Henrietta's three surviving children. Like she said, that two of her children are in, one is in assisted living, and then one is in a nursing home, and then one, he's Uncle Lawrence, he's like 80-something years old, and his health is failing. So it would be nice if they could get, the top-notch health care, get a nurse to come to their home to take care of them 24 hours instead of them being in an assisted living.
Now, one of the things Rebecca has done with her well-gained profits from her book, you've set up a foundation with some of it, and the Henrietta Lacks Foundation. What do you do with the funds? I mean, it's a wonderful thing.
So when I started working on the book and kind of understood the role that money played in the story, I really didn't know when I started anything about beyond I wanted to know about Henrietta and the cells. So as I started to understand the story of the money, I told Deborah that I didn't sort of want to be another person who came along and potentially benefited from the cells without doing something in return. I also was like, I can't pay you for your story. First of all, I have no money. I was broke. I was in debt. I was paying for this with credit cards and student loans. But also, there's a code of ethics in journalism that says you can't pay people for their stories. But so I said, you know, if I ever get this published and if anybody ever buys it, I'm going to set up this foundation. And I envisioned it as an education-focused foundation, which Deborah wanted. You know, she really believed that if the family had access to a better education, then some of this might not have been so traumatizing for them, that they may have been better equipped to ask questions in the moment, or just some of it would have, it would have been easier on them. But also she just wanted future generations to have access to things that they she didn't have. So in 2010, I started the foundation, and it does beyond education now. But so far we've given out 56, I think it is, grants to just members of the Lax family, and that's been for in education we've gotten. It's private high school, there's been community college, trade school, undergraduate, grad school. One of Henrietta's great-granddaughters just got her RN with our help, and then a lot of medical care also. So we've been able to help with some things that maybe health insurance doesn't cover, dental care. Mm-hmm. And you know, so that's, we also, the mission of the foundation is to help people who've made important contributions to science without their consent. So members of the families of the Tuskegee Syphilis Studies men also qualify, or there are actually a lot of people in this country who qualify. And we've given some grants to the Tuskegee Syphilis Studies families for education. And we're just, you know, my hope is that the movie is going to help bring the foundation to a whole other level so it can go on indefinitely like the cells and just keep helping people long after I'm gone. Yeah. Thank
you. So we're sadly almost out of time, and I think we could talk a long, long time, but I'd like to throw around Robin a question at everyone. The book, the movie, can a book and a movie really create change? Can it change hearts? Can it change society? What do you think?
I believe so, absolutely. I think art definitely has the power to motivate people, to educate people, to inspire people. I know it does for myself, so I really hope that that the film sheds a whole new audience on the story and on the novel and on the book, and you know, so I was really, like Renee, felt very honored to be a part of it and to sort of serve the story and, you know, to bring it to a hopefully a bigger audience.
I totally agree with her. I had the privilege of, you know, right before doing this, spending a couple years doing Hamilton, and I had like a first, you know, front row seat to watch a lot of the ability of art and just a true story about someone that no one knew have real impact politically. I mean, with our currency, and even just in the way we kind of talk to each other in the discourse and what we're talking about, and I see this as just as important, just as impactful, and just as, you know, potentially life-changing. And I think the proof is sitting next to me, you know, in terms of, the power of just knowing the story, however it comes, through the film, through the book. And that's, I think, the most important thing to me is you know, what you guys, we were just listening to you from the room and listening to you talk about not knowing, you watching Deborah, you know, hear people speak about things that they knew that they didn't share with her. So that's really the theme. I'll quote Hamilton. I'll say, who lives, who dies, who tells your story, you know. The important thing is to ask and to listen.
Absolutely. Well, I do think the book has changed a lot of people just by going on speaking engagements and interacting with the folks that we encounter, because we have several people. I mean, we have people that come up to us and say, oh my gosh, how your grandmother has helped me carry a child because of vitro fertilization, or someone may have had cancer and they said, because of your grandmother, I'm in remission of cancer. So yes, I do think the book has made some positive changes, and people know the story behind the healer cells. They know that it's a woman who had a a life, who had a story, and who died at a young age and left behind five beautiful children, and how she has changed the world. I mean, changed just drastically.
I just want to say that when I go to the hospital, I meet nurses, doctors, and give my name, they'll say, and they'll go, oh, are you related to? and of course I said yes. And I met several nurses that have said, you know, that book, reading that book really has helped me. And especially the ones that are doing work with patients for research, they said it really has helped me to look at people that we're doing the research with as a person that could be my mother, could be my father, my sister, or my brother. Mm-hmm. And it says my compassion for those people have changed because before it was just one of those things where, okay, this person is coming in, I'm gonna do this for this person, do that, and go home and forget about it. Mm-hmm. Now they don't do that. She said, a couple of them had told me that it gives them thought when the person walk in. Mm-hmm. Now they realize I'm dealing with a person, even though they're coming in for research, they still are a person.
I feel like I can't even say anything about it. I mean, can art change a thing? Absolutely. And, you know, I'm excited about the movie kind of bringing this to a whole other new audience. And as a person who cares deeply about science, I know you and I share this, and the importance of communicating science to people, getting kids interested in science. And one of the things that I have been, everything you guys said has been so amazing to see, the scientists, the impact on patients and scientists, but the kids. Watching young kids come running up to us at speaking events going, oh my God, can I have your autograph? You're so cool, can I have a selfie? Like, we're science, this is science stuff, right? Like, and it's been amazing to watch how humanizing, you know, not just humanizing in the book, and now it's, I mean, the movie is gonna be a whole other level, but also meeting you guys, right? Like, they come out of the pages of the book and are standing there in a school, and kids go nuts. And I think the impact that will have on future generations is kind of hard to underestimate. It sort of blows my mind now that the book's been out long enough where I periodically will get emails from people who seem like grown-ups who say, I read your book when I was a senior in high school, and then I went to, and I now I'm about to graduate from medical school or whatever, and, you know, and they talk about how hearing us, you know, speak at their schools changed the trajectory of their lives and the way they thought about things. And, you know, to think that a science story could do that is just, it is the dream. I mean, that's what you started off in the beginning. Every science writer, you know, this is what we want. We're like, science is amazing. People should understand that, you know? And so for me, that's one of the great things in addition to all the greatness of Henrietta's story and what having that out there has done.
So we owe Henrietta Lacks, all of us, a great debt, and we owe Rebecca Skloot a great debt.
And Deborah Lacks.
And every woman who fights to make the world a little more just.
Absolutely.
So we thank you for coming out this evening.